In the big fights, getting him Sergio, getting him the middleweights, is he getting close to the point now where other guys are going to want to fight him? I mean, he's gained such a following, he's known so well. Is he taking that role without actually, you know, obviously you still want to fight Sergio, but can he take that role without actually having to get in the ring with Sergio if he can't do that?
He has taken that role. Gennady, with the ticket sales in Madison Square Garden, we almost had a sellout. It was 160 tickets short. So he's proven not only his TV ratings, his ticket selling ability, but now, because of the relationship with HBO and the purses that the opponents can be offered, he's pretty much taken over that mantle where we can offer significant purses for someone to fight Gennady. He's a big name. You know, if I go down the list of everyone who has either avoided him or hasn't been ready or turned the fight down, it'd be a much longer list than whoever he's fought already. I mean, we don't like to make that public, but HBO knows, and I've had an extensive conversation with Peter Nelson about all the different possibilities, and it's, I have to tell you, it was the hardest last year trying to get someone to even fight him. And when Gabe Rosado, he was a mandatory for the IBF title at 154, and he gave up that shot in order to get into the ring with Gennady. So we gave him a lot of credit. Same thing with Matthew Macklin. I think Macklin probably made just as much on the fight as Gennady did. But, you know, those are the type of circumstances we had to go through to get a name like that in there. Same thing with Curtis Stevens. He called out Gennady, and then, you know, we worked out the financial details, and he got in there. That's why we give Adam a lot of credit, because that was a very easy negotiation. And, you know, he just wanted a shot at getting the title opportunity. But I think, you know, whether it's, you know, there's a number of names out there now, but now the, before it was kind of like, either promoters wanted to say nobody knew who Gennady was, or it wasn't financially rewarding, and he's definitely crossed that barrier now, where everybody knows who he is now, and the finances on his fights are there where, you know, there are big fights. I mean, we'd love to make a unification fight. You know, at some point down the road, if you know, politics gets worked out, it'd be a great fight with Quillen, who's also undefeated champion. You know, but Sergio Martinez would be. Would certainly be at the top of the list, you know, because in order to prove you're the best, you have to fight the best, and that's where we think Gennady's the best, and obviously Sergio and his promoters and the Andrews think he's the best, and that's the only way to find out.
Tom, can we say, I mean, is it accurate to say that on Gennady's side, you guys have never turned down an opponent that was cleared by HBO?
It's absolutely true.
Not to name names or whatever, but have some of those opponents who were cleared by HBO, have some of them been super middleweights and even light heavyweights?
Yeah. They haven't approved light heavyweight, even though Abel has approved light heavyweight. HBO didn't really feel that was the right direction to go into at this particular time.
But have there been names of super middleweight stands out that HBO has cleared as opponents that you guys said yes to?
Well, I'll give you a name. I mean, not to call anyone out, but Edwin Rodriguez was one of the names that we were looking for last January for Madison Square Garden, and he turned down the fight, and that was at 168. But, you know, he was willing to fight on reward. And actually, we couldn't offer him $1 million at that time, so sure, there's certain economics involved with it, but, you know, there are a lot of names that if you go down the list, he hasn't turned down one name. And Abel, to his credit, hasn't either.
Gennady, mentioned 175 right now. Oh, 168, 175. How do you feel at 175? If you do move up, do you think you could move back down? Because, you know, we've seen sometimes a lot of muscles gain and the fighter's not the same anymore.
As he said a while ago, his focus is 160 right now.
Yeah.
There's so many fights out there, 160, until he exhausts all those opportunities, until they say that they don't want to fight anyone and the money's available. Mm-hmm. And I think it's unfair to ask him to move up to a weight that is beyond him. I'm not saying that he's not going to. I think that we would if it was the right fight, just like he would go down if it was the right fight. But there's four or five names at 160 that I think have to say absolutely not, that they're not going to fight us or go in a different direction. Then he's supreme at 160, then we move up to the next one.
No, I was just curious because for that to even be brought out, I thought like, well, wow, like from 160 to up to there, I'm like, why would that even get thrown out?
If there was a fight at 175, this man walks around at 167, 168, whether he's training or not training. When he goes to camp, just like the Klitschko, he gains weight instead of loses weight. So if he's 167, 168 when he comes to camp, if we had a fight at 175, he probably wouldn't come in any more than 172, 70. He just, his body, he feels comfortable. He wouldn't just put on weight because he's fighting at a heavy weight. So it would be easy to go back, to answer your question, it would be easy to go back down to what he was fighting at.
And that's really the legacy and the focus right now.